Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
It's a
pleasure to be here again. So, Simon Kenjian from Microsoft Research. Our lab's just down on Station Road. I run this Azure for Research program. So, how many of you have heard of Azure for Research and Dr. Ram? Okay, good. Right, cool. So, that's really good. So, I'm going to talk today about reproducibility, open science, a subject that's very dear to my heart.
When I was from my tiny village, she is not in Italy. My sister was really young, but I loved to build
It's sort of scanning the USB and then like doing so. It's a really cool video about genomics. I'm going to show you. I'm going to talk about reproducibility containers and then the cloud in terms of what the cloud can do to help as well. And so I think, we agree there's actually this really serious crisis in science around reproducibility. This graph is from a Nature paper, scientists lifting the lid on reproducibility. I think it's particularly important that we see a lot of evidence of this within sort of pharmaceutical companies that are trying to reproduce work that's done in universities. So to develop a new drug, it costs billions and billions of pounds. But often a lot of those leads and those very promising sort of opportunities come out of academic research. And pharmaceutical labs will read a paper and try and reproduce that. And it's not like they're trying to do it on the cheap, but they'll actually spend a lot of money to try and reproduce a scientific result that, say, a researcher has published from a university. And there was a study which showed that by far the majority of those attempts failed. It was in the sort of 70% range. And so we think about science, we think about open science, and we think about, obviously, being able to reproduce things to make sure that the science is robust. But there is actual serious money at stake here as well in terms of translating academic research into some sort of opportunity, okay, which has a return on investment to society and also to companies, not just pharmaceutical companies, but any company. There's a lot of talk around reproducibility. And because of this, we published a paper a couple of years ago with some of my colleagues in the Software Sustainability Institute, actually Lars as well. And so we came up with this, which was basically the fact we know about reproducibility. That's really hard. But actually, this is really easy. Why don't we just do this? Why don't we as scientists just guarantee irreproducibility? Why don't we guarantee that all of our work cannot be reproduced by other people? It's a lot easier. And actually, you could argue that's what's done today. That this is actually what people do in practice. And so what we did was we said, well, actually, let's set out some principles. So we wrote a paper, and this is our archive. You can check the publication date as well. We slightly got it wrong, but it was end of March, early April. So these are the top tips on how to guarantee that no one else is able to reproduce your work. Okay. So make sure that your big picture, talk about what the possibilities are with your science. Stay high level, put it in pseudocode. Don't put it in real code, put it in pseudocode. Okay? And just make sure, right, that you don't obscure it with any actual real details and the little tricks you need to get it to work. Okay? Make it short and sweet. Okay? Clearly the reader will spot anything that's not obvious. So you don't have to write it in the paper. Okay, it makes it much easier to read. And you're the expert, right? So you're the only person in the world that can even hope to understand this. And don't share. It's yours. Why would you want to share your science? And you could argue that lots of people in practice take an approach that's a bit like this, rather than what we all understand to be useful science. And actually, the push for open science and reproducibility is not just coming from researchers like us, but it's actually coming from people who are defining the research landscape. It's coming from Commissioner Modas, who runs all European research. He owns Horizon 2020, he owns PRACE.
He owns all of those programs.
And he cares about this. He cares about open science. He cares about reproducible research. Baran Mons, who is the chair of the expert panel on the European Open Science Cloud, is hugely passionate with the FAIR principles about findable, accessible, interoperable, and reproducible research. Is from him, and he is the chair of the expert panel on the European Open Science Cloud. The European Science Cloud isn't the be-all and end-all, but it's a good 6 billion euros of research funding, and the people in charge of that are very passionate about reproducible research and open science. So when you and the people in this room are doing this, these people want to know. I've met with some of the commission. They want to know who is doing open science today, who's doing reproducible research today. They want evidence, and the people in this room are the ones who are doing that. So it's very exciting to meet here. And when I go and meet with these people, I talk about these types of meetings, and I talk about some of your projects. I think I mentioned your projects in England. I'm there for some of my best people. So, and he was very excited. Tell me more, tell me more. So, you know, this is really hot. It's you know, you can feel that it's gone up. So this diagram is from my friend Carol Bogle. She's one of my heroes around reproducible research, and I'll talk about one of my other heroes. And we need to understand what we mean by reproducible research, and there are different things. To do robust science, you need to rerun. You need to rerun. I need to be able to rerun. I need to be able to take what I did 6 months ago, rerun it myself, and get the same result. If I don't do that, I'm not a good scientist. So that's a baseline. You could argue it's a low baseline, but you could also argue that some people, you could argue a lot of people, are not able to do that. So you need to be, when you think about reproducibility, you can think of it in a very selfish way, of how can it help me? You know, the real use case there is when you submit a paper for publication, and you get the referee's comments a few weeks back, and they say, oh, this looks a bit funny actually, can you rerun those with these parameters and reproduce that figure, and then we'll accept it for publication. Right? It's a real requirement for this. It's not just, on wishes. Repeatability, so can someone else in your lab, so if you are a PhD student or a postdoc and have a new PhD student come in, can they reproduce what you do? I had to do this when I did my PhD, I took over from a guy called Nick Clark, and I had to rerun his code. And it was an old code that ran on InMOS TA100 transputers in Occam. How many of you have run in TA100 transputers in Occam? Yeah. And I had to run this code. It was a beautifully written code. It was very asynchronous. and it took me about a year to do that, but I just translated it into CMVI as well. Modernized it, but to understand enough of the code, to get it to run, to debug it, to get the results out that he got, and then translate that into CMVI, it took a long time, so it was pretty complicated. I did an Occam. So in your own lab, when you're in a lab and you have multiple people, that again is a real requirement. Right? If you can do that and you have a new PhD student who comes on stream and they can do that repeatability in a week, then you're ahead of the rest of the world if you can do that. So repeatability. Now replication, I think, is a bit more, and often when we talk about reproducibility, we actually often talk about replicability. And actually when we talk about containers, that's actually, a lot of us are actually talking about that. Reproducibility is harder. So can I take an experiment, okay, and actually run it on a different experimental setup and get the same result? Now I would argue that is robust science, okay? Because if you have a hypothesis and you can only do it in a single lab under very, very certain conditions, that's a very fragile result. But if other people can find the same hypothesis, prove the same hypothesis, screw it, not others, and do it in a different lab with a different setup. Okay? And there's a bigger, there's a thing spinning up in supercomputing. You know how it is when you run a supercomputer and you run it on a different architecture and you get a different result? It's pretty fragile science. You know, it can be a chaotic system, absolutely, but then you must run enough to get statistically significant results, right? Any wet lab scientist will do that. It's no different. Hard to do with a large Hadron collider, because there's only one. But reproducibility, a again, it's actually running on variation on the setup. So that's slightly different to replication. It's like reuse is even harder, okay? But reuse is obviously what we want to get to. Okay, so when you think about the FAIR principles of Baramons, the last one is what you want to do, that's the R in there, which we are. So when we talk about reproducibility, we should be clear what we mean. And Docker's quite interesting, because Docker, you said the variation on the experimental setup was, I want to get the same setup running on my laptop, running on a Cambridge HPC machine in Singularity, and on the Azure cloud, and on Amazon cloud, and on Google cloud, and I want to get the same result, okay? That's a variation on the setup. You could argue it's that replication, it's replication of running on different hardware, okay? So we need to be clear about that. We don't need to get too hung up about it, but I think we need to be clear on that. This is one of my other heroes, Lorraine Barber at Washington University. While I was writing TA100 code, she was running stuff and starting to do stuff on GPUs a bit later. She's a huge advocate for open science and reproducibility, and actually she's implemented this in her lab with her students. So do follow her on Twitter, tell her I said hi. And this is her manifesto. And if you're serious about this, and you're in a leadership position, okay, you have people underneath you and all that, then you know you need to set some principles. So when you have a new student come in, and we do, you know, graduate school training, okay, we now talk about them, about research data management and some of those things, there's software carpentry. But this is fantastic, I think. So actually teach your students when they come in about reproducibility, tell them why it's important. You can often sort of teach young dogs new tricks, but teaching old dogs new tricks is harder. Version control, okay, well I think, how many of you don't believe in version control? So version control, again, it's obvious to us, but it's not obvious to new PhD students coming in. So we carry out verification and validation. Verification and validation, they're two very different. We need to understand that those two things are different, and we need to do them and document them accordingly. Verification is something you can do with unit tests, for instance, which is saying, I've got a set of equations. Am I solving that set of equations correctly? You should have unit tests for that. Validation is a bit harder. Validation is, I have a set of equations which I think is modeling the real world. Does it model the real world? And that's a very different thing to verify. Verification means you can catch bugs. Validation means, is my simulation correct in the model of the real world? I used to do CFD. Is my turbulence model actually replicating or reducing flow separation and those types of things? So, sharing data, plotting scripts, but sharing them in a way that other people can use them. So, using Creative Commons type licenses, for instance. Upload your preprints to something like Archive. Depends on your discipline, obviously, but works for Lorraine. Release code at time of submission to a paper or a journal. This is interesting because getting along those lines of an executable paper. And then she adds a reproducibility declaration and then develops a consistent policy as she keeps up. You look on her website, she's got a beautiful website, by the way. She's got all of this on the website. So having some principles that you stand by and implement them. Again, Lorraine's one of those real leaders in the research world. So do follow her, do you know, get in touch with her about. So I run this agile research program, and I've added the word reproducible in here, so I want to talk a little bit about some of the things that the cloud can do to help with reproducible research. It's interesting, so the cloud's big, okay, we've got a big cloud, we announced a couple of extra regions in South Africa. What it means actually is if I've got some research and I deploy it to a cloud in the UK and I've got a collaborator in South Africa, they can deploy it in South Africa or they can deploy the same thing in Australia. They've got some containers, just with a, you know, changing the script, they can deploy it into a different data center. So being able to reproduce results because of a large data set, but doing it local in terms of in the same region is useful. So the cloud's quite good for this type of collaboration around the world. A cloud you can trust. You need to make sure that if you're doing something with sensitive data, OK, okay? That you're doing it on a platform which is secure and trusted. I'm doing a lot of work now in AI and health. There was actually a meeting last Monday in Kingston around understanding patient data and how we can use patient data to do better research. And a cloud platform is interesting. So it's interesting. IDC have a report out and they say that any organization that is not in the public cloud by 2020 will be considered an insecure organization with an insecure IT infrastructure. So cloud is becoming the default for secure and trusted IT infrastructure. You look around at all the cyber attacks. Cyber attacks are now being done by nation states, okay, who also do things like build weapons of mass destruction. Okay? Your IT infrastructure has to be defendable against that. Okay? We have 3,500 people working full time to do that on our cloud. We spend $1 billion a year on that. Okay? When you're building out research infrastructure, you are vulnerable to that. Okay? So again, being clear on what you're doing is important. And technology is coming along, and people like the Ministry of Defence, for instance, in the UK, are taking that line, and the National Health Service as well. So it's an interesting time. It's interesting from 2 or 3 years ago when I started this programme. It's moved on a lot. And so it's interesting. So you get a lot of the benefits of being able to move things around and share, but also in a very secure and trusted way, which is useful. And the other thing that's kind of interesting is just the availability of infrastructure. So we think about CPUs. I'll talk a lot about CPUs and how we can scale those. A lot of people use GPUs as well for things like deep learning. How many of you use GPUs? Thinking about GPUs, okay, so it's pretty cool that GPUs are available on demand. And what's interesting that as Moore's Law comes to an end, there's new hardware. So we're making a bet on FPGAs, field programmable, gate arrays, programmable hardware, okay, doing things like machine learning on programmable hardware. And so with the Azure Cloud, we have all of this infrastructure. We're continuously developing new hardware. In order to stay ahead with this sort of big investments. It's kind of interesting the level of investment as well. So this is one of our data centers in the UK, in the US. Okay? And if you look, you can kind of see the cars, you can count the buildings. We've kind of deployed what we call pods. On the right hand side, you can see these pods. And it's pretty big. Okay, it's pretty big. Right, those halls are probably a big university data center might be half the size of. What's interesting is the pace of change and the fact that we're deploying 2 data centers in South Africa, we're deploying data centers in the UK, we're deploying centers in India. The rate of building and development is huge. So what's interesting here, look and see how big that is, that when you fly around to the other side, it looks a bit like this. And that's the building site for the expansion of that data center. So the level of scale that we think about is like this. So keeping when we think about things like data, we think about genomics data, we think about pushing out tens of terabytes every day, that's hard to sustain. You can do that today maybe with a lot of work, but actually sustaining that on the long term when you look at that growth of data, you look at that requirement for doing machine learning or data science, the level of sort of development investment that we're bringing, I think, is something that researchers can benefit from. So I'm going to talk a bit about containers. I think you've heard a lot about containers, so I'm going to be fairly lightweight on this, but I think just a general view of what containers can do for us. They can give us consistency and they can give us efficiency, and I think we saw that previously. So things around consistency that are interesting are rapid deployment, fast iteration, reproducibility, running across different infrastructures, immutability, we can have that and we can snapshot that, and that's really good. And then we can also separate out different services, we can do high availability. So lots of these things you can do with virtual machines, but containers give us something that's a bit more lightweight, potentially a bit more dynamic. Certainly a lot easier to use in terms of if I'm a researcher and I've got a container, I can put in my applications, my data, and I can then reproduce that, and it's a really, really nice one. You can do that with a virtual machine, it's a bit more heavyweight. So I think containers are really, when I started out this program, we were working with researchers, they were talking about pushing out VMs, sort of snapshotted VMs with stacks on. And people still do that, and it's a good model, but I think containers is a nice evolution of that sort of model. and so on. Azure is kind of interesting. We're big on open source, actually. We're the Microsoft the number one contributor on GitHub today. It's a platinum member of the Linux Foundation. In fact, there's a guy called Ross Gardner who's one of our open source champions. He's actually the head of the Apache Foundation. So we're pretty big on open source. We're very big on containers. We've got a very strategic relationship, for instance, with Docker. And so what we do is we try and make sure that our cloud can support these types of container technologies. And actually, more than that, we support them in Windows. So we support containers and Docker containers on Windows Server and in Hyper-V. So we support things like Docker, Docker Compose, Docker Swarm. This is just normal Docker Compose and Docker Swarm, but we make it really, really easy for you. We support things like Mesos, Mesosphere. How many of you use Docker Swarm? How many of you use Mesosphere? How many of you have heard of Mesosphere? Okay. And then we support Kubernetes. How many of you use Kubernetes? Okay, cool. So we make sure, and we work very hard to make sure that these solutions work extremely well and integrate very well. And in fact, we go beyond that. We use a fabric underneath. Okay, so we have this service fabric that ties everything together. Then we put that as essentially the plumbing that Stephen's going to sit on. But we also open source our container service, the Azure Container Service. It's open source, it's on GitHub. It's the only container service on any cloud that supports multiple open source orchestration frameworks. Okay, so you're not tied in to one of those and you can play around with different ones. And so we do, like I say, support all of these things. We have something called our Azure Resource Manager templates that kind of manifest. Okay, that you can just single click and deploy then a whole bunch of infrastructure. And so you can deploy a whole Kubernetes infrastructure, for instance, using one of these templates. So we have this model with the container service to make it really easy to wrap complex containerized solutions and also storage and virtual networking and other things in a single template. So that's something that I hope is interesting. You play around and you can do containers on your laptop, but then when you want more infrastructure. So I want to talk about HPC, I want to talk about how it works with containers, I also want to talk about Phoenix. Okay. I think this might be, oh no, I'll talk about HPC. So one of the nice things, and I'm an HPC person, nice as I am, see my help design, here it is, one, with Oz Parchment and the team, which is the UK's first university-run HPC service. And one of the things, how do you define HPC? A lot of people talk about HPC. I think today there's a very simple description of HPC. It's a system that's got something like below 5 microseconds of latency between nodes, right? That's the definition. You'll see a lot about cloud HPC. You'll see a lot about you can't do HPC in the cloud, and that was true. But it's not true anymore because we've deployed HPC hardware. We've deployed real HPC hardware. This is Fluent. I used to do a lot of these types of simulations. This is the sort of thing that Formula One team was probably running about 5 years ago. So it's 140 million cell CFD computation, and that's a generic Formula One car symmetric model there. And what you should look at is this one, which shows the scalability. And so the dotted line is theoretical speed up, and the red line is speed up on actual work. So that's 1,000 cores, which is a decent sized computation. So it shows that you can do, like I said, real HPC linear scalability up to thousands of cores. And how do we do it? We do it like this. We deploy a cluster hardware. We deploy RDMA. We deploy InfiniBand. But not only that, we make sure the performance of InfiniBand in a virtualized environment gets bare metal equivalent performance. We get 2 to 3 microsecond latency. And we get that not just on things like LINPAC, so that top right is from this benchmarking paper. You can see the blue arrow there is Azure at the top left, that's scaled really nicely. The green, sort of light green, is any ISCs on-premise HPC cluster. And the ones that don't perform so well are not Azure, but they're a different cloud. So it shows you what happens, the effect. And it's just, they published a paper, and there's lots of comments on it. It's really obvious, right? If you don't have the low latency network, you're not going to run HPC properly. Okay, so it's obvious, right? So LINPAC is what it is. It's not a real application benchmark. But it shows up scalability, so where it's latency sensitive. So we quite like this paper. And this shows what you can do with something like NAMLE. Now this shows what you can do NAMLE running linear, actually super linear, because we're doing it relative to a 16-core computation, because this test case actually two slides run us, a small machine. So running something on 4,000, this is about half the size of a tier 2 HPC machine. Okay, some of the newer tier 2 machines. Needs to know about 20 minutes, 15 minutes. Okay, so it shows again that real HPC, hundreds or thousands of cores, and I think that's quite useful for a lot of people. I think these are snakes. Oh yeah. So Chris, hopefully you saw yesterday talking about Phoenix, and we were working closely with Chris. It's great working with Chris. He's got one of our actual grants because he gets stuff working, but also when stuff doesn't quite work perfectly, he just pings us and our engineering team goes, oh cool, send us a bug report, let us know what's happening, we'll fix it, and we give a lot of other fixes. So that's part of our Azure research program. One of the reasons for having it is to get detailed feedback that says, actually, this particular use case doesn't work. Here's some code, here's some scripts, this is what I'm doing, this is my setup, and we can go away and have a look at it. And that sort of data from real intelligent users who really, really know what they're doing, particularly around things like HPC and containers, is really, really valuable to us. And so working with Chris has been absolutely fantastic, and some of you as well. So definitely want to work more with you. I want to get to the snakes. All right, we've got snakes. Here we go. I'm going to talk about snakes. I love this.
There are 5 species of snakes in the Malayan jungles that are able to transform their skeletons to glide through the air. A study has revealed exactly how these gliding snakes contort their bodies to cover a great deal of ground. When it leaps off a high tree branch, it rotates its ribs forwards and upwards, making its body double the width. This transforms it into a much flatter, aerodynamic shape, similar to an airplane wing. It moves its head back and forth, which passes waves down its body like it's swimming in air. Professor Jake Socher carried out the study by creating a plastic copy of the snake's cross-section and placed it in a tank of flowing water and gathered data on the way the water moves around it using lasers and high-speed cameras.
Why am I talking about
flying
snakes? Because I want to talk about Lorraine Barber and what she's doing in her lab. So Olivia is one of Lorraine Barber's PhD students, the person who actually was challenged with reproducing work from a previous student. And this is the research, this is really great. Thanks Olivia for the slides. This is a presentation we gave at PAR-CFT in Glasgow just recently. So you can see in the top right there, the normal configuration, and then it sort of flattens itself out into this sort of more wing-like configuration to do the glide, which is really interesting. And then the paper that they published on PAR-CFT actually shows some Lorena's keynote, where she's lent me some of the slides, goes through how to reproduce these results. Okay, so things like running a different compiler matters. Things like having the right CFD mesh matters. Okay, any of you doing CFD, Foundation for Dynamics? Okay, so you know how horrible it is to do a mesh, and then you get the mesh wrong, you get the results. So reproducibility is interesting. You don't just need to give them code and data, you need to have the mesh. Okay, and that's what Olivia found out. So his paper's really, really interesting around that. But what's interesting as well is he was running on the HPC system. So Colonial One is an on-premise system that he was running. And it shows there in blue is Azure with a really nice, actually a much lower latency than the university machine, and a much better NPR performance as well. So that's quite interesting that he was able to do that. And then when he can run his results on the Azure cluster versus the local cluster, they could get sort of comparable results. You know, I'd sort of argue, I used to do a lot of benchmarking. And when you do benchmarking, you have to be very careful about what's faster or what's not faster because of error and just different noise. So I would say actually this just shows it's comparable. Basically. You can argue the toss on which one's better, but it does show that decent performance. But what's interesting is the A series nodes that we've got, the A10s and A11s there, and they've got InfiniBand. And then these NC series are the GPUs, so they do a lot of work around GPU workloads. What's interesting is that on Azure, it's a very transparent model. If you look at the pricing, you can see it's kind of simple. NC6, NC12 costs twice as much as NC6, NC24 costs twice as much. It's pretty linear, the pricing actually. So we're not kind of trying to catch people out. But what's interesting is they were looking at, what if I run on CPU-based InfiniBand cluster versus GPU, and that's really what their work And so what they did was, for this case, it was interesting, they could run it on an HPC machine, but then running it on a GPU, because they were doing a lot of work on GPU, they could actually do the same piece of work a lot quicker, okay, because they were running on a GPU. But it's really interesting, because then they can compare the costs between the two. Okay, so it's really interesting, they do a lot of GPU work. So you think about, should I run on a GPU, it's kind of interesting, because you've got a kind of cost model in here that you can think about. And again, here, where they're running on cost, and that's 8 times 16 nodes there, so that's a decent number of CPU nodes versus running on a GPU. It's interesting, in the cloud, they can do this. It's really easy, there's that kind of ability to take the code and run it on different machines, and that's kind of the point I wanted to make with the cloud. It just makes it really easy to do those sorts of comparisons. One of the things we have, so if anybody uses an HPC machine, you kind of have there's a big machine, you have a queuing system, you submit stuff into the queue server, whatever, and you submit into the queue, you wait in the queue, everyone's okay. We have something called actual batch. So one of the things with the cloud is you don't have a queue, okay? You just have a bunch of machines. In fact, you have, theoretically, an infinite bunch of machines, right? You should never really have to wait for anything. So having an HPC machine you don't have to wait for is quite nice. And so what actual batch allows you to do is kind of wrap an application. So you can basically say, I want to run my application on 16 nodes, go, and it just goes, spins up all the other cluster of cool machines, it runs, and then it finishes the job and shuts it all down. It's really, really nice. The reason I mention this is we've got something called Batch Shipyard. Batch Shipyard is the same thing running Docker containers. It's the same thing running Docker containers with InfiniBand. It's the same thing as running Docker containers with GPUs. So this is that combination of HPC, real HPC, GPUs, batch, okay, which is on demand, and containers. Okay. It's quite a lot packed into this. And it's quite useful. And so this is something that we're sort of promoting quite a lot for people who are interested in containers as a nice way of essentially wrapping up. You see these recipes. So we've got Cafe, we've got Keras and Theano, we've got Nambu, we've got OpenFoam, we've got TensorFlow. These are containers. These are little recipes, and then you can take that container and you go bang, run that on a couple of hundred nodes. All in Python, because it's Python-based. So this is a project, it's fairly new, we only released this in September. It's on GitHub, so have a look at it. Let me know if you've got any good experiences, let me know if you've got any bad experiences, because we'll fix that. We do some work at the Alan Turing Institute. We have a partnership with the Alan Turing Institute. Marve there, who's a social science researcher, actually was doing a really cool project using flicker photos to sort of track protests, to see where protests were going on. And she's got access to a university issued machine. But we did some training, she looked at her batch, and then she looked at her shipyard. And she's just really excited about that. So she was able to run on sort of 300 cores, basically using this batch shipyard on Python. And you know, it's really, really nice. No queues, okay, just bang, go and run it. So yeah, it would have taken her 10 months to run a laptop, and she could do it in a week. Okay, so it's really kind of really nice way of speeding up her research using that batch shipyard. So I talked a lot about HPC. I like HPC. We have HPC. It's a really kind of nice feature. But big data is quite important. The sort of play between this and containers, I think, is something that's up for discussion. But I just want to show you what you can do with big data in the cloud. Cornell have this project called eBird. It's a sort of citizen science project. And they're using Azure and some of the big data platform on there. So I thought I'd show you this.
Ornithology really taps into our wonder about the fact that birds fly. I love the unpredictability of birds. I love not knowing what I'm going to find in the morning when I wake up and go out birding.
Birds are wonderful indicators of the environment. So they tell us something about the quality of the environment that can help us to manage it better.
You go into the field and basically you listen to birds, you watch birds, and you record the birds that you see. And the idea was, could we somehow gather this information that somebody in India had, somebody Brazil has, somebody in Guatemala has, and bring them together into one unified database. And we've done that with eBird.
Our goal is to try to provide information for the scientists and for decision makers in conservation. So we practice open science. We use a series of software products that are all open source. Our core for the analysis, but do to be able to scale. complex environment.
We now have 325 million records, 10 million records per month.
We have gigabytes of data to go into our model. We then generate terabytes of information through the modeling process.
To analyze migratory patterns for species across North America would take us 2.5 weeks. We need larger compute resources. We decided to use Microsoft Azure because Azure had less a combination of cloud computing and open source tools in an environment that was easy for us to support.
Azure is not just a Microsoft solution, meaning it doesn't require you to run Windows on everything. Many people don't realize that over 20% of all of our systems out there are open source.
Azure really boils down to the large amount of compute capacity that can be accessed globally. And what it does is it says to any organization in the world, you don't need servers in your office.
Libra team has certainly benefited because of cost reduction and time to market. It took them several weeks to get one batch done, and now they can do one batch in just a few hours.
It allows us to apply machine learning techniques. We're able to actually make almost real-time pieces of information about whether birds are increasing or decreasing, how they're changing throughout the seasons.
Thanks to tools like Microsoft Azure, we're able to show bird watchers when there are 300,000 of them working together for a common purpose, can fundamentally change how we know the world around us.
It's not just about helping birds and a way that we can use the data for bird conservation, but how we can leverage that information to help us move towards solutions to these grand global challenges.
So I just like that, this is a really good example of using the cloud for big data processing, in this case it's Hadoop. It's using something called HD Insights, so this is big data clusters, you can do Hadoop, you can do Storm, you can do Spark, you can do Kafka, you can add in more cluster types. And you can do this through one of those R templates, and you can just fire this off through a script. So you have a script, a big data cluster, it's kind of really useful if you want to share some of your work. We do a lot of work on AI and machine learning. I kind of want to touch on this a little bit. We've got this project actually around reproducible research called Coder Lab. It's now actually led by Percy Lang at Stanford. So it's this concept of using worksheets, and it's used at quite a few machine learning conferences now. So when people publish their papers, they put their worksheets into Coder Lab. And it uses this model of kind of having an experiment and then having the provenance of that whole experiment from raw data to numbers to put into the paper. We call them bundles, and the bundles are then immutable, okay? And they really represent kind of that pile of stuff you need to reproduce. And then you have a worksheet which actually then organizes that sort of pipeline. There's a, you know, you can have a lab notebook, there's a tutorial, there's an executable paper. So this CodeLab project's been running for a while now. Like I said, we've kind of moved it out into the community with Percy Langer at Stanford and some other collaborators. So do have a look at CodeLab and see what you think. It's a really important project and more people to contribute. And like I said, it is being used in conferences now as a way of people sharing their results when they submit their papers. I talked a bit about GPUs, this goes a bit more. So we were really excited because we've got a really strong partnership with NVIDIA, but we now announced also Pascal GPUs, so P14 and P100 GPUs are coming as a preview program for that. And again, our GPU clusters are InfiniBand RDMA enabled as well. So the ability to run these sort of large clusters in the cloud is quite interesting for a lot of different applications. Chris Russell, again at the Alan Turing Institute, was using GPUs for some of his computer vision work there, where you can sort of spin stuff up. And it's quite useful, even if you've got GPUs under your desk, if you've got a paper deadline and you want to expand out what you want to do. I sometimes say the difference of using cloud versus using your on-premise is the difference, sometimes it can be the difference between a good paper and winning best paper. Because how do you compete? Okay, if you want to do, you know, bigger, better experiments, and if you're constrained with your own institution, the cloud gives you that possibility to do that. And you have to make a call on when you want to do that. There's a researcher actually out in June doing some machine translation around 114 GPUs. He had one of 8 categories in the 2017 machine learning workshop. A machine translation workshop, which would be in some of the big companies like us and Google. Okay, so it gives you that sort of levels of playing field, again, having access to this cloud. about technology. There's this quite neat thing called actual machine learning. It's a kind of workflow. Okay, I used to do a lot of work in workflow, scientific workflow, so it's kind of similar if you look at it with things like that. But it's for building machine learning models. But what's quite nice is you can publish this as a web service, you can publish it online so other people can take it and run it. There's a whole gallery of tutorials, for instance. It's a nice way of sharing. It's a nice way of teaching machine learning because you can pull data into the top. You can train a model, you can compare models, you can look at ROC curves, you can compare different algorithms. And what people have done is they've taken this, they've kind of left a blank box, it's kind of they're filling in the blanks with the algorithms, but the students have it there in front of them. So they can focus on looking at the algorithms, okay, without having to worry about the plumbing. You do need to teach them about the plumbing at some point, but actually if you're principally teaching them about machine learning and algorithms, this can be quite a nice way of exposing them. And this is kind of what it looks like. You can push out APIs, for instance, click the button, you can take an app and turn it into REST APIs. I want to finish off talking a lot about notebooks. I love notebooks, I love iPython notebooks, I love Jupyter notebooks. We love notebooks so much that we created a service called Azure Notebooks. We worked with Fernando Perez for a long time, actually. We funded him a period a while ago when iPython notebooks nobody really knew about them or cared about them. And so nobody was really funding them, but we actually helped Fernando out. So it's really great to see how iPython notebooks and Jupyter notebooks has really taken off. So he's a very good friend of ours. So we've created this service called Azure Notebooks. What's interesting here is they're notebooks on the web, but what's different is they're executable notebooks. So these things you can publish, you can share them in multiple libraries. But then somebody can clone the library and run it, and look at Mike Rapture at Sheffield's done a blog post looking at the performance of these things, and they're pretty powerful. I think so they're half as powerful as the HPC nodes at Sheffield. They are shared, so they might not be like that all the time, but we do some load balancing. So here at Cambridge, Garth Wells and actually Chris Richardson are using them for the first year Python course for all of the undergraduate engineers. So the people who sit in this lecture room, right, 350 of them, use these actual notebooks for their computing course. And this is the GitHub page, okay, so it's on GitHub, and you'll see a line under viewing and running there. There's a link there to notebooks. So there's NV Viewer, okay? People are used to NV Viewer. But this link here is actually to the Azure Notebooks. So when you click that link, you get this. So this is called a library, okay? So you create a library of notebooks. And then this is shareable. So there's a URL, you can email this or stick it on GitHub. And then what happens is your students log in, they can sign in with their university account. And they hit clone and run. It will take that entire library of notebooks and clone it and copy it into the student's user space and account. And then that's their own executable notebooks that they can play around with and run. So it's a really powerful way of sharing notebooks. It's really, really powerful. Teaching doing the data science course, for instance, this is fantastic. We use this at the Allen Turing Institute for the training course there. Currently, it supports R and Python. If anyone's interested in Julia, email me. I know Steven is, and I know a few people are. Trying to ascertain. The junior team is actually moving all of their stuff onto Azure. They're part of our Microsoft Accelerator with Microsoft. So these notebooks are really cool. And like I said, they're executable, so this is what the students kind of go through. And you can see it's a standard notebook. There's just a little thing up here that tells you it's running on Azure or Azure Machine Learning. So, you can even console in, you can put in, you can do pip install, you can do lots of stuff. So this team here, okay, the LIGO team, have an open science center, okay, which is fantastic. And this is what it looks like. And if you go to the open science center and you click on the tutorials page under events, you'll see here the little Azure button. So what they've done is they've taken some of their data, they've stuck it in the cloud, they've taken the notebooks, which have got their processing, stuck it into Azure notebooks, and made that available. So this is the spectrogram analysis code for them, and this is the result when you run it. And again, you can see here, this is running in those three Azure notebooks. So it's a really, really useful platform if you're trying to share notebooks in Python or R. So yeah, go ahead, I mean, it's free, go ahead and use it. If you do use it, let us know, because we can publicize that for you as well and get the word out. So I'm really, really excited about this. Loads and loads of people are just going, wow, that's really cool. And it's really easy, you don't even need an Azure account, you can assign it like this. So I'd like you all, and I have to still, I don't know if I've got any stickers, let me know. Do epic research. The cloud lets you do epic research. I think what's more important is that the cloud will do epic, really useful research. That's what we want. Hopefully I'll show you a little bit of that. So to help with that, you've got these codes. So you should have the sheets, and it's got all the instructions. If you get any problems, email me. Okay, and I can help you out with that. So they're valid for a month. You do have to validate them by the 23rd of July, I think. You need to sort of turn them on by then. And then they're a month after that. So do have a look at that. If you like that, or if you kind of go, actually, I need a bit more, then our actual research program is still available. It's still kind of ongoing. We have a deadline like every couple of months. So the next deadline is the middle of August. But you can put a proposal in at any time. Okay, it just means we evaluate them every couple of months. Ping me. If you kind of go, wow, actually, cool, I need it before the 15th of August, then email me. And we can take a look at it. That's no problem. So we're so really keen to see if this is useful for you. Okay. We know it's useful for a lot of people, and people are already using it. And you've seen some talks today. Actually, yesterday there was a talk from Newcastle. Yeah, we talked a bit about Agile a little bit, yeah. So yeah, and so you know, really keen to see what people are doing with that and to support that. So go and do epic reproducible research. Thank you.